bulletin, but that we line up with the spirit of what God wants to do in the place. Amen? And I know, without a shadow of a doubt, if you come into the house of the Lord for this morning and you ask God to touch your heart, He will touch you. If you ask Him to speak to you a word, He will speak to you a word. Amen? If you ask for a healing in the house of God, today I know the Lord's going to heal you. If you ask for anything that's going on in your mind, for the Lord to give you wisdom and direction and strength, if you come into the house of God and He does not do that, then He's a liar. And my Bible says God does not lie. Amen? Amen. So I know if you come into the house of the Lord today, no matter where you're at, the Lord will touch you, the Lord will heal you, the Lord will strengthen you, the Lord will encourage you, as well as some things we might not like, but the Lord will point things in your life that is not right. Amen? Amen. The Bible says He chastises those He loves. If you walk out of this place and there's absolutely nothing that God had poked in your heart and said, all right, all these things you've done well, but there's still something I want to grab a hold of, then we've missed it. Amen? Amen. So I pray that you walk out of here today encouraged, strengthened, edified, as well as going out and share what God is doing in your life and in your heart and in your family and in your church. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. I want to let you know this started on Wednesday.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And I want to let many of you know who don't come on Wednesday. It's not a forceful thing. I know many of you work, but Wednesday we have church as well. Amen?
Amen.
And on Wednesday, I want to give a testimony before we even get started. Brother King went in and I was having a colonoscopy on Friday. And on Wednesday is the Lord, I know without a shadow of a doubt that the Lord healed me. And don't yell yet, amen, wait up a second. It's I know this, and from the bottom of my heart, I know I was touched by God. I know this. It's not an assumption. It's not because I read about it. It's not because I got a fortune cookie at the Chinese restaurant and said I would be touched. But I know on Wednesday I was touched by God. Amen?
Yes.
I was told 2 weeks ago that I would probably have to end up having colon surgery and take out 6 to 8 inches of my colon. And we know what that means. If you don't have a portion of your colon, then you have to put a colostomy bag. Amen? And I can live with that, right? Christ is sufficient. Amen? But I know that God showed me that He would heal me. And before it started, before we even started the service, I just felt the presence of God. And I knew that God was telling me, I'm going to do something in the midst today that y'all might not be used to. Amen?
Yeah.
And I'm going to touch you today.
Yeah.
I know Pastor Ken, and I believe that the Lord shared my heart that He was telling me, you always pour now, you're always giving, and you've always praying for others. And He said, today is your day. I know that on Wednesday, God said,
prayer. Not that y'all enjoyed it. Not that we had a vote. That was the top
That's right.
I'm here to please the Father. Amen. Amen. So I got down on my knee. As soon as I did that, Edison O'Donnell ran up and started crying out to God. And immediately the Lord says, I'm not done yet. I thought service was over with. So okay, I stepped down from the pulpit and I went to sit over here and looked at my wife, my beautiful wife, and she was praying. And she said, baby, I'm hungry. And I said, amen. I said, let's start getting our stuff together, and then we're going to go, and we're going to pack up. And then Pop came, Brother Lamar came to me, and he anointed it with oil. And the Bible says, if you're sick, to call the elders of the church. And it says, they'll anoint you with oil. And the prayer of the righteous and your faith will heal those that are sick.
Hallelujah.
It's not an assumption. This is in the Word of God. This is not if you feel like it. This is based upon the Word of God. So, Bob came up to me, and I'm not going to lie to you. You know, I'm very honest. I was like, all right, Bob, you have about 5 minutes. And all the brothers came, and it was a peace of God that came upon my heart, that I believe God asked me in my heart and said, this, Brother John, if I don't hear you, will you still serve?
Hallelujah.
And I said, God, it's not easy for me to say, because the way I feel right now, I'd rather go home to glory.
Yes.
And he said, if I don't heal you, will you still have peace that you understand that I'm still with you? I will not leave you nor forsake you. That I will, even though you have a thorn in your side, that I will be that grace to you that you need in that time of need. Amen? And I said, yes, Lord. And immediately, saints of God, in my heart when I said that, His peace came over me. That, to be honest with you, I know it might sound weird to some of you guys, but it felt like I was in another planet. Amen? It felt like God again. It felt like, oh, I don't care what happens right now. And then they prayed about 25, 30 minutes for me, and we were done. And I'm like, praise God. Then we're going to go ahead and get out of here, close up, turn on the air condition, lock the doors, turn on the lights. Let's go. I'm kind of corralling you guys. We started moving out, and then Brother Pena and Brother Daniel Pena and Brother Brandon and Brother Kenneth and Brother Nathan and a whole bunch of the men came back about 5, 10 minutes later. And they said, let's pray for you one more time for your COVID test on Friday. That God, that we have a good report, that God comes back and that He says nothing's there. And I said again, all right.
Yeah.
All right, buddy, I'm going to do that when we pray for you. And I said, all right, you're looking at your watch. I know he prays. He prays for at least 30 minutes. But I already had peace, so I said, God, whatever. I'm willing for them to pray for me, but I'm also willing if this takes me home to glory, it's a win-win situation. Whatever your will is, God. And he started praying for me, saints of God. And I'm telling you, I felt the presence of God that I've never felt in a long, long time. In fact, probably ever since the point of salvation in the Mojave Desert. And the Lord touched me. And it might be weird to some of you guys again, but I want to share with you that the Spirit of God, when He touches you, you'll do things you never thought you could do.
Yes, sir.
And I was trying to fight it. Is you know how you get kind of weak? And I don't know if you ever felt the presence of God like that before. I got flushed. Amen? And I was like, oh, good God, what is this? And all of a sudden, as I felt like I was going to black out, not a bad thing, I almost felt so much peace that I was like, I'm the God born of glory. And I fell, and I remember falling, and I fell face forward, and I fell on the ground, and my head probably sounded like a watermelon when it hit the ground. And saints of God, is when I was out, is I was felt like I slept for almost 20 hours. Is the Lord, I know without a shadow of a doubt,
come on,
that I felt the Lord reach inside of me. Now it might be weird for some of y'all, but hold on for a second. I know without a shadow of a doubt, I felt it was like hot lava almost. Moving through my body, and I believe the Lord without a shadow of doubt grabbed it and pulled out whatever sickness there was and got rid of it. Amen. Now you can shout. I want to share this with you today. God is no respecter of persons. Amen. And I'm going to tell you now it's no longer I've read about it. I know.
Hallelujah.
It's no longer that you've been healed, I've been healed. Amen.
Come on.
I know that my God still is the same yesterday, today, and forever. Praise be to God. Now, I was satisfied with doing whatever the Lord had His will for me, but I know there was still a great work to be done in Brokerage and around this country. And I'm not, it's not a false humility. I'm like, God, I'm like Moses, you know, stuttering tongue and all that. You got somebody. You got a Joshua lined up. And God says, I'm not done with you yet. Amen.
Yeah.
Praise be to God. That's an encouragement, saints of God. That's to understand that God is really in charge of every aspect of my life. And to understand that God loves this house. I believe that without a shadow of a doubt, that God loves the people in this house because there's people about Jesus. Amen. They're not about a denomination. They're not about a church, a pastor. They're nothing else but coming and seeking to be closer to the Father and to minister His word of grace to this lost and dying world. Amen.
Amen.
Praise be to God. Now we're going to start the service. Amen.
Amen.
We're not going to be that alone today, but if we are, I got grace and mercy. Amen.
Amen.
Turn with me to Joshua chapter 5. Joshua chapter 5. We've been in Joshua for about 3 weeks, 4 weeks. Joshua chapter 5. I encourage you, if you come to the beginning, I encourage you to get a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, let us know and we'll get you a Bible. Amen. I encourage you to come into the house of God with a Bible. I know many of you use your phones, which is fine. Many of you use your iPads, which is fine. But I do encourage you, it's very tempting to hop back and forth to text message and Twitter and Instagram and all those things, amen, when you have a phone. I'm looking at my wife when I'm saying that, amen?
Yeah.
She don't do that, she listens. I know she does, amen? That's a big up for that, really. So I encourage you, saints of God, during service, I know that many of you is, as the Lord has a word for you today. And how many of you, if I was to tell you today, that many of you sit in the house of God, even I believe already, it's already happened to some of you.
Yes,
but some of the strongholds in your life is going to be broken down today. Amen?
Amen.
Some things that have been holding you back, some things that have been keeping you bound. It's the Jericho wall. Amen. It's an impenetrable wall. And I believe that today, God is telling you without a shadow of a doubt, today the walls are going to come tumbling down. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Can we give God a shout even before that? So the scarlet thread. about it, but I've told you at least 30 different sizes of this wall since I've been ministering about the wall. Amen. It's 40 feet high. I'm not exaggerating. Fish is this big.
Yeah.
But factual is the outer wall was 6 feet thick and 20 feet high. The inner wall was 12 feet thick and 30 feet high. And there was a 50-foot guarded walkway between these two walls. From a military standpoint, can we just be honest and say, that's impenetrable. There's no way man's going to be able to do it. It's impossible.
Right.
Thanks to God, I want to share with you today, for this ancient city, Jericho, which was over 2,500 years ago, it represents those things that we are rooted in our hearts and our lives that only God can remove. How many of you know without a shadow of a doubt that I'm speaking to you today? If you have something rooted in your heart that is a double impenetrable wall, you've been trying for years to be delivered from it. You've been trying for months and years to be set free from it, but it's still a wall. And you know what? They could not get all that God had for them until those walls broke down and they got through Jericho. The promised land wasn't right at the beginning. The promised land was after Jericho. They had to get through these impenetrable walls. And it's many of you, you're settled right across the Jordan, right at that bank. Yes, you are in the promised land.
Come on.
But you really have not yet understood the victory that's in Christ. You talk about it. You proclaim it. But it's a head issue and not a heart issue. It's not deep down in your heart. And it's about time as a church, that we get past this Jericho city that has been hindering many of you from going into the fullness of Christ. From you having joy unspeakable and full of glory.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Come on.
Put this right here. Rabbi, I guess a person in case of, that's my amen corner.
Come on.
The saints of God, as we read in the Word of God, I want to read Joshua chapter 5, verse 13. And it came to pass when Joshua was by Jericho that he lifted his eyes and looked, and behold, a man stood opposite of him with a sword drawn in his hand. And Joshua went to him and said to him, are you for us or for our adversaries? So he said, no. Listen to that.
Come on.
Are you for us or are you for your adversaries? No. He didn't even answer. But as commander of the army of the Lord, I have now come. And Joshua fell on his face to the earth and worshipped him and said to him, what does my Lord say to his servants?
Come on now.
Saints of God, I want you to understand today that with the presence of God, this individual Joshua meets outside the walls of Jericho, identifies himself as the captain of the host of the Lord. Joshua is praying, seeking God for direction and for wisdom. And a man, which I believe, you might have different doctrine, but he fell down and worshiped him and he didn't shake it up. So I believe that it was a reincarnate or a pre-Bethlehem Christ Jesus. I believe that without a shadow of a doubt. So he fell down and he worshiped him. Usually in the Bible, when you worship an angel, you say, stand up, we like men. But this man didn't say that. So saints of God, and then you understand the position of God as he met up with Joshua. The Lord tells Joshua that he is the captain of the Lord of hosts. That is, he is the one who is always victorious.
Hallelujah.
He is the one who is walking in victory even before this battle is going to be fought.
Come on.
In other words, he is the one who is in control of all situations, and he is merely reminding Joshua who is fighting this battle for him.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Saints of God, we must understand that we are to yield to his power in every area of our life and trust him. The victory has already been won. How many of you understand the word sanctification? Raise your hand.
Come on.
Watch what I'm asking.
Yeah.
Oh, saints of God, sanctification is a setting apart. It's a setting apart from the things of the world to the things of God, but it's also a setting apart from the flesh, and now you're walking more in the Spirit of God. So right here in sanctification, it is in the place when he sees this man with a sword. Joshua falls down and acknowledges him as Lord.
Right.
Now, Joshua, that's off limit to God.
Come on, man. Yes,
sir. Be careful saying no. Because the Lord will find you. No, God, I've given you everything you have. We're about to find that out if you have. Amen.
Yes.
When you draw close to the Lord and you bow down at His feet, you realize very quickly that there's things in me that's not right. The closer you draw to Christ, you don't become this high-minded person of thinking that I've made it. In fact, it's the opposite. You realize very quickly, I really don't know much, God.
Amen.
Saints of God, when Joshua fell at the feet, it represented the power of God. When Joshua meets this man, the Lord Jesus Christ, there are a couple of things that are strange about this meeting, and I wrote them down. First, there's the Lord's answer to Joshua. Joshua asked him, are you for us or for them? And the Lord answered, no.
Yeah.
And that confused him. No. That's a riddle.
Yeah.
And I'm going to be honest, as I was writing this, I went, that's really strange. And it is a matter is why he said no, because the Lord was saying, I'm not here to take sides. The Lord was saying, I'm here to take over.
Hallelujah.
Are you for me or are you for them? And he said, no. No. He says, I'm not here to take a side in this situation. He says, I've come to take over this entire battle.
Amen.
Then the Lord tells him, it's loose one of your shoes, one. And I got to ask you, why just one? You remember when Moses went to the burning bush? He told him, remove both of your shoes because you're standing on holy ground. The same here, but the Lord tells him, take one off. Why is that? Saints of God, back in the days of old, is that when a person couldn't pay a debt or when a person could not keep a covenant, is that they would give them one shoe to an illustration to let them know that I'm not able, but you're able. So Joshua doesn't take off both of them. Joshua takes off one shoe as a representation to let him know that God, what you just asked me in this battle is too hard for me. I am not able, but I'm giving you this to let you know that I'm not able, but you're able.
Amen.
And you know how I know this? I use scripture when I, so you're going to be all over the Bible, but in Ruth 4, chapter 4, verse 6 through 7. And the close relative said, I cannot redeem her for myself, lest I ruin my own inheritance. You redeem my right of redemption for yourself, or I cannot redeem it. Now this was the custom in the former times in Israel concerning redeeming and exchanging to perform anything. One man took off his sandal and gave it to the other, and this was a confirmation in Israel. So guess what? Boaz bought Ruth, and the other man said, I can't do it. So he gave him a shoe and said, I can't, but you can.
Come on.
So Joshua met him and said, look, I know I can't do this. This is an impossible task, but I know you can. And I'm going to share with many of you in this place today, many of you need to go home one shoe.
Amen.
You've been walking your own walk. You've been talking your own talk. And God is saying it's about time that I have your life, not part of it, but all of it. You've been trying to figure out things yourself. You've been trying to fight this battle, these deliverances. You've been trying to figure out your own life yourself and lay it down in your own agenda. And he says, I'm asking for your shoe today. Come and give it to me. That's a representation to say, God, I can't, but you can.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Saints of God. For Joshua, this was a challenge for him to come to the place where he could admit his own weakness and the inability to gain the victory. Do you realize before you can have the victory, you've got to admit that you can't gain it yourself?
Amen. Come on.
How many of you in this place, and I do want hands to raise that we're family, but how many of you place, be bound by drugs, alcohol, pornography, doubt, unbelief, unforgiveness in your heart? How many of you been bound for years and still bound by some of those? Raise your hand. Don't put your hands on. Every one of y'all hands should be up. In fact, some of y'all toes and both hands too. Amen. Don't lie in the house of God. Amen. I'll tell you a story about lying in the house of God. Saints of God, for us, for you and I, as God was calling Joshua to surrender everything to him. I can't win the victories I need in my life, but you can. What I'm saying is that we need to come to the place of absolute surrender, to that place where we and all we have are at the feet of our God, to the place where we are willing to say once and for all, I can't, but Lord, you can. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's the place where we all need to be in here today. Saints of God, I want to encourage you first, but it involves confrontation. When you first come to the Lord, you're going to be confronted by a man with a sword. The Word of God, the Holy Ghost, is going to confront you. Amen? And the only thing you're going to be able to do is say, I surrender. Because Joshua, mighty man as he was, he didn't pick up a sword and say, who are you? No, he fell at his feet. And you know, the Holy Ghost convinced many of your hearts today and has before, that you try to justify your sin or justify why you're where you're at. But the Holy Ghost comes in so patient, so loving, and says, there's a root to that problem. And I know it. Are you ready to hear it? And he touches it. And you don't try to fight against it because you can't. You know he's real and he's honest. See, you can get mad at us for preaching and get mad at us for telling you. But you know when the Holy Ghost comes in your heart, who are you going to get mad at? God? Saints of God, also in chapter 6, 1 through 5, is you realize that it involves confidence, another major step in a pathway towards spiritual victory of our strongholds in our life, is you need to understand God's promises. Turn with me to Joshua chapter 6. Turn, I don't hear anything. Oh, you're already there. I'm about to rebuke y'all. It says, now Jericho was straitly shut up because of the children of Israel. None went out and none came in. Oh, glory to God. Did y'all hear that? None went out and none came in. Saints of God, when the Spirit of God is present in a place, the adversary don't know what to do with himself. He goes out, people are going to be delivered. If he comes in, people are going to be locked the door. Just stay in hideouts. And I believe right now where we are at this church, not because of a new beginning or a pastor, because you have hungry hearts for God. The devil cannot stay in this place. The devil's going to have to flee. That's why we have so many doors. Amen. Hallelujah. And the Lord said unto Joshua, see, I have given into thy hand Jericho and the king thereof and all the mighty men of valor. And ye shall compass the city, and all ye men of war, and go around about it go around the city once, thus shall do it 6 days. Saints of God, we got to understand that it involves confidence in what God has already told us. The people of God forget what God has done. That's what this is written for. For us to look back and say, if God did it for them, God is more than able to do it for me. If God healed a leper, God can heal me. If God saved a man that was a murderer, saints of God, a murderer, Paul, ran a little crew, a gang, to kill Christians, but God saved him and put him in a pulpit to be an apostle of God's house. God can't do anything. If God can grab a Rahab and put her in Holy Ghost too,
come on,
hallelujah,
hallelujah,
and save her. And now her name is written for all of eternity, what we read about in the Bible, and not only written about, but in genealogy of Christ. Come on.
Amen.
Saints of God, God's promises. Before Joshua goes to battle against the city of Jericho, the Lord reminds him of the promises of the Lord. Listen here. Joshua 1:3. And I say this to every person that's in this place, please receive it by faith. Every place that the sole of your feet will trod upon, I have given you.
Amen. Come on.
Come on now.
Say it again.
Every place that the sole of your feet trod upon, I have given you. As I said to Moses, no man shall be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you.
Amen.
I will not leave you nor forsake you. And said to the men, I know the Lord has given you the land, that the terror of you has fallen on us, and that the inhabitants of the land are faint-hearted because of you. You know, they were saying inside of Jericho, saying, started doing is I try not to look at people where they're at. Amen. I pray and ask God to show me where they're going to be at, Brother John.
Come on. Yeah. That's good, man.
I don't want to see where they're at right now, but God, you revealed to me by the Spirit of God where they're going to be in a couple months. I know they're bound right now. I know they're afflicted right now. I know they're weary right now. But God, show me a couple months from now, a couple weeks from now, that it's going to be a mighty man, a mighty woman of God that's going to say, if not, go out, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Saints of God, the past promises reminded Joshua of what the Lord had promised to do long ago. Rahab had a 40-year promise. The present promise reminded Joshua that the Lord had not changed his mind about the matter. How many of you know that his mind don't change? Your mind is confused with changes. His mind does not change. Our God is still the same. Yesterday, today, and forever. But Pastor, you don't understand my situation. I might not, but I bet you. I know for sure he does.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Come on.
Saints of God. 1 Corinthians 15:57 says, but thanks be to God who gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 2:14 says, now thanks be to God who always leads us into triumph in Christ. Always. Romans 8:37 says, yet in all things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
Hallelujah.
Oh, it looks impenetrable. For me, a little bitty man like me, I could probably fit through the keyhole, Brother Steve. And I would look at it and try to figure out my own way, like the Spartans did. You know, they try to build a, whatever the name was, build a, that horse to put inside. You know, I've got some military mentality. I can figure out how to get inside that wall. But many are going to die.
Right.
But if you do it his way and the right way, all will survive. And all will go to the promised land. Saints of God, I want to tell you here today that it's God's plan, not your plan. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Good. How many of you would have thought on the surface God's plan for Israel, for them to have victory, was really strange? All right, I'm going to tell you. What required for the Israelites and Joshua to do to bring the walls down? Nothing.
That's good.
Stand there.
Come on.
And watch God move.
Come on.
Saints of God, what was his plan? I'm going to tell you his plan. You're going to find it kind of weird. In fact, what I'm probably ministering to you about you to be set free and delivered, you're probably looking in the same way that Joshua did and the Israelites did. This is what he told them. Take seven priests, carrying seven trumpets, and we want you to walk before the ark and walk around the city for six days. We want you to parade yourself around this city with, guess what, with guards on all the walls, all the way around it, point bowing arrows at you. And we want you not to bring a sword, not to bring a shield, just walk around it.
Think about it. Crazy. Come on.
When I come to you today and I say it's as easy as just put your trust and faith in Christ and your name can be written in the Lamb's Book of Life and all of your sins can be washed away, it blows some of your minds.
Right.
But I say today that you don't bring anything to the altar but your heart and say, God, I give you my heart. I want to be set free from pornography, drugs, alcohol, lust, pride, loving money. I want to be set free from that and say, God, so give me a plan, give me a program, give me a formula. And think about what I told you. March for 6 days around the walls of Jericho. I gotta find that church. But listen here, saints of God. And if the priests were to blow the trumpets and the people were to walk behind the ark and the whole parade was to walk around the city once a day for 6 days. And then on the seventh day they were to walk around the city seven times. At the end of the seventh, they were to shout. When this happened, the walls would fall down flat. That's what he told them. Now you're sitting here today, I know many of you. You think the same thing in your life, whatever bondage, whatever affliction, whatever's going on in your life, you look at it like doubt. No, they did. This is impossible. You mean walk around for 6 days, once, And on the seventh day, when you're tired and weary, people are going to have to walk around seven times.
Yeah.
And then you're going to scream before the walls go down. Because you're not looking at if they're going to go down. You're shouting because you know they are coming down. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Saints of God, I know this lesson becomes very clear in my heart. Again, they were taking seven priests. Seven is the biblical number of completion of fullness. Seven. The priests are a picture of our advocate. The one who stood between us and God. This is the picture of the complete and perfect advocate. According to the Bible, his name is Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.
1 John 2:1 says, my little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
The righteous.
Amen.
If I can preach on that for about a moment.
Come on.
Then they were to take seven ram's horn trumpets. And this is a ram. As we know, many of you guys, we know the ram is a picture of an atonement. We know that when Abraham took Isaac to the top of the mountain to put him to death, it was a ram that was in the thicket to provide atonement. So seven priests. You're listening. The picture of completion. And then they're going to blow a ram, which is a sign of atonement. Blow a horn.
Yeah.
And then they're going to take the Ark of the Covenant. And the Ark represents the Lord Jesus Christ in his fullness. Inside the Ark was a golden pot of manna. Inside of it. That told you God is my provider.
Amen.
It reminded them, saints of God, that God has all the provisions we need. And an Aaron's bud was in there as well. Now this was a stick. Amen. That a piece of a bud. And some of you, we have many landscapers in here. But out of this dry withered stick is a little leaf shot out. And it was green. And it was a representation that even out of this dead, dry, sinful world, that the Savior would come.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Saints of God, this spoke of Christ's power and his authority. And then inside of it was the tables of the law, the Ten Commandments, the thou shalt not, to point you back to Christ. It's not for us to keep the law, saints of God. It's impossible. That's why Christ came. He kept it all in the fullness. I know some of you still live in legalistic laws. I must pray, I must fast, I must read, I must go to church. When you get a relationship with Christ, it all changed from must that I get to.
Yeah.
Many of you, if you would have missed church today, you could have had an excuse to sin all week.
Yeah.
So I said, you missed. But saints of God, what he was telling them is this whole, the ark was a representation of all the fullness of Christ, of the law of God. That said, you cannot keep this law. Remember when Moses came down from the mountain and the people, they had the law. Thou shalt not lie. Thou shalt not kill in adultery. Thou shalt not blaspheme the Lord first. No idols. No covetousness. And you know what the people said? We can keep all of those things. And immediately, you know what? Aaron had broken before he even got down the mountain. They were worshiping false gods and idols. So what Moses does a sacrifice. The law is the schoolmaster, the voice of Christ. You're not supposed to keep it. It's impossible to keep because we have someone who has already kept it. His name is Jesus.
Hallelujah.
In Hebrew, he's called the high priest. Hallelujah. Now I want you to know today that I'm not voicing that we can sin and just do as we please.
Right.
In fact, the more you understand God's grace and mercy, the least you should desire in your heart to displease the Father.
Amen.
Because you understand His grace and you understand what it cost Him on Calvary, that He sent His very best, that the least thing you want to do is to offend the Father and go against His word. It's not that you have a church looking at you or a pastor watching over you, but it's something that's in your heart, the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Jesus. Saints of God, they were simply to take these things and walk with them around the city. I know y'all and I know me. If I'd have told y'all that, half of y'all would have left.
Come on now.
You didn't hear from God. Many of you would have said, if it was sure. Feel like a flat tire. Many of you would have said, Pastor King, you sure you heard from God? I heard from God. But what about our swords? I know we got to bring our swords. You know, I'm really, really good with that sword. You know, our shields, I'll be there to protect the rest of the people. You know, no, you're leaving everything behind. Everything behind. We're going to walk in an army, in our line together, in unity. We're going to walk around here. Oh, okay, but we can walk and we can sing, right? No, you can't say nothing. You mean we can walk and quote scripture to each other to encourage each other? No, you're not going to say a word. And I believe God already knows each and every one of us because it allowed them to walk around that place once a day for 6 days. Many of you would have started, but it's going to be over.
Yeah.
I think this is foolish. And by the time you said that, by the time we got back to Joshua, you all quit. Amen. So he said, I don't want you to say nothing. I don't want you to do nothing and say nothing. Just walk around and be obedient. That's hard for the children of God to do, is just to stand in what Christ has already done for them. Let's be honest. It's hard for you to sit here today and to say, I don't have to do nothing, Pastor King, but trust and believe in what he's already done. Yes. That's hard for you. That's why it's a fight of faith. Well, I don't see anything. Praise God. They didn't see the walls go down, but they shouted before they did. Saints of God, what a lesson for us in the church. And it's really no secret. I want you to understand today that I'm not giving you something that's impossible. As that young man that came to the man on that show said, you can do it. Yeah. Right, Brother John? You can do it in the Lord. I'm not giving you an impossible to walk out of here and to say, oh my God, that's difficult. Lord, I can't do this. I'm giving you the simplicity that's in Christ. The Bible says that. Be careful that we don't walk away from the simplicity that's in Christ. Some of you are so high-minded in the scriptures that you've left the first fruits of God, that He saved you by grace. And there's nothing you can do to gain favor from God but to continuously trust in what He's already done.
Come on, man. Hallelujah.
Saints of God, you cannot live the Christian life this way. You don't have to live it. How many of you say, I don't want to live it?
So, yeah.
But if you yield to His plan and you let Him live through you, then I'm telling you, this church will be a light and a salt to this world because they really look at you, not just because of what you said to your mouth, but they're going to look at the countenance upon your heart and your mouth and your eyes and say, that church knows about Jesus. Yeah. Because they have victory in their heart.
It's not the description.
somebody to say it? Nobody wants to say it.
Come on.
Are you tired of waking up every day being defeated where you're at? And really don't even want to go on sometimes anymore. You just really don't want it. You just say, God, this is a good race while we're in it, but I'm tired of this. I'm done with this. I'm ready to just give this up. And some of you right now are in a season of sin. And sin is fun for a season. I'm going to tell you that. But when it runs out, it's very clear that that season is going to end. And the same person that led you into that sin is the same person that's going to condemn you. He's going to say, I told you you would never be anything for God. I told you that you would never come to nothing. I told you that you would die and go to hell. I told you. The same one that throws that sin in your face, the same one that is the kill, steal, and destroy. He leaves you in a carrot, then when you're in it, he lies to you, so you stand.
That's right.
But then you look up and you say, oh no, devil. Oh no, I might have slipped, I might have sinned, but I'm going to repent, I'm going to confess my sins, and I'm going down past Jericho.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I want you to know, years later, after the walls of Jericho fell down, there was a blind man that was healed there.
Come on.
You don't realize the things in your life that would be delivered from. Christ comes back later and heals in that exact same city. What happens if they would have been defeated? That man couldn't have been in there worshiping God or desiring to be healed. You don't realize, but you right now, individually wise, is going to, it's more than just you. Get out of the selfish mode. It's you, your family, your kids, your grandkids, them grandkids down the road, a church, a city, a nation. This is much more than just you. Saints of God, I want to tell you today, you need to start trusting. Rest in the finished work of Christ. Realize that you have no one to please but God. Oh my God, that's so much freedom in saying that. I have no one to please but God.
Amen.
I'm not here to get your vote. I'm not here to get a card. I'm not even an amen. I'm here to know that my Father says, well done, my good and faithful servant. That's all I want to hear, saints of God. Saints of God, I'm going to tell you today, there's nothing left for us to do but rest in the finished work of Jesus and to enjoy the rest of the victorious life in Christ. That's it. Saints of God, it also involves determination.
Yes.
As I've already been said, this is simply what they did. They did it God's way. I know there's many of you even in here, the devil's telling you that's impossible. You're already scheming to try to get out of the altar call. You're already scheming. You're going to be in the bathroom getting coffee or leaving before. The devil that wants you to stay bound where you're at. The devil wants you to stay exactly where you're at. Because you will never be all who you should be in Christ until you're totally free. Free of unbelief, free of doubt, free of this hidden sin that's in many of our hearts in here. The devil's already put it in your mind when he calls the altar call. You're going nowhere. First thing you need to pray for is pray for deliverance and pride. Amen. Saints of God, I know the Israelites were tempted to fight. They were good at it. They've won many battles. Same thing with you. You've won many battles, you think, by your own power, by your own wisdom, and your own mind. Some of you, you've got jobs. Out of your own mind, your own wisdom, and your own credentials. Amen? Some of you have got healing from your own. I figured it out. I know what was wrong with me. I started doing this. And you see, we create to try to figure things out on our own and do things ourselves. I got in a financial bind, but I figured out how to be set free from it. You created to always try to figure out what is the adversary. You just need to throw down that shoe and say, God, I don't know.
Oh, amen.
I don't know. There's freedom in not knowing.
Amen.
Saints of God, when you do it God's way, there will always be victory.
Amen.
When we, the church, ever learn this, it isn't about new means or new methods. We don't need new Bibles. Our Bibles are good enough. We don't need new kinds of services. Pastor Ken, I really got a lot more into that worship. We had words on the screen. Close your eyes and listen to what God is speaking to you. Amen?
Amen.
I'd have surely Amen. It's a 6-week sermon to learn how to pray and be set free. And then they have the communion. The Lord's Supper. The Lord's Supper, we're going to show you the Lord's Supper by you drinking it and you actually eating the flesh, that you're going to have victory in your life. There's always a scheme, a program. It's the same book with different colors. It's you to stay bound. It's you to stay not having victory. The only Miranda, go to the Christian bookstore. They got evangelism 101 or things to get you on fire for God. I know what gets you on fire for God. Come to the altar. Give God your heart and watch what He does to your heart that has been so selfish on your own mind, your own agenda. He'll give you His heart, then you'll start evangelizing. Hallelujah.
That's good.
Saints of God, maybe we need to have this preacher come to revival. Boy, that preacher I heard was good. He's going to come and stir us up. Saints of God, I've been to many revivals and I've done many revivals. And I went back a year later, those same people at the altar repenting about the same thing. I called to check up on the pastor. How they doing? Oh, boy, they're on fire for God. They're hitting the streets. They're here and there. They're there and this. They get what they tied on. That's something you were there. Woo! It's there. They're coming back. But it won't last unless it's a heart thing. It won't last unless God gets to the root of your heart and He takes it out.
That's good.
Saints of God. When the preacher's gone, a few days later, the same thing comes back, but guess what? Now it comes back with a vengeance. How many of you know that?
Yes.
You've been delivered, or you said you've been delivered, and all of a sudden you're on that internet at night, wife's sleeping. Huh? I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to. Greater she is in me, He's in Christ. Greater is in me. Amen. Guess what your finger does? Click. And you're the one that said, I would never do it. You're the one that said, I'll never fall to that scheme of that devil. I know I'm clever. He's much more clever than you ever be, saints of God. What about this? I've never done something about my brethren. Yeah, but not me. I know because I've experienced that before. I'll never do that. I'll never, out of the same mouth that blesses God, curse my brethren. No, I'll never do that. You're the same one that is the division started in our midst. You know why? Because you started leaning on your own strength. You started leaning on your own ability. And every time there is a disaster that's waiting behind that, and that is death. How many of you in this place said I would never do? Maybe you did.
Yeah, come on.
Huh? Amen. Look, amen. I'll never do that. The Bible says, be careful, watch, so you don't fall.
That's right.
Don't think you're high-minded anymore, you're greater than Him. I'm so sad. What did you do, my brother? That's sad, man. Oh my God, I can't believe He did that.
Yeah.
You're on the phone and on text and on email. I can't believe He did that. That's 2 weeks later, you're doing the exact same thing. Saints of God, I want to tell you today, it involved dedication. Israel walked around that city 6 days, and when they did, what happened? The walls of the city came down? No, nothing happened. 6 days. What happened when they walked around 6 days? What happened?
Nothing.
When they walked around the city 6 times on the 7th day, what happened?
Nothing.
Some of you are at that nothing right now. You're about to throw in the towel. You're about to quit, but that's when God's about to move in a great and mighty way.
Yeah.
I haven't seen nothing. I haven't heard nothing. Nothing's going on. I keep marching and walking and serving and praying and believing and trusting, and nothing's happened. Just wait. Hallelujah.
Hang on.
Hallelujah. Saints of God, the number 6 in the Bible is a representation of man. Nothing, absolutely nothing can come from man but wickedness.
Right.
Marched around 6 days. What happened? Nothing. Because nothing can happen in your own strength.
Yes, sir.
Man can try as hard as he pleases in his own power, but he would never obtain victory. Can someone in this place say amen that know what I'm talking
amen.
About?
Amen.
But yet, you see that on the 7th day, they marked 7 times, which is a number of completion of God's fullness. What if they didn't stop given up on God, on people, on church, on everything else. Many of you are so close to that. You're in your sixth day, and God's about to wake you up because you're weary and you're tired, and about to say, you ready? He calls you all out, and he says, come out. And you're like, oh, today's going to be the day. We're taking that all down today, and you're weary, and you haven't eaten, drank much. Haven't slept much because you're concerned because you're less than a couple feet from a wall with your enemy. And he comes out and he says, all right, we're ready. We're going in today. And he says, march around seven on the seventh day, seven times. Right when you're the most tired, is the most weary, God says, do it.
Come on. Why is that?
That's where many of you are right now. Because the Bible says, in your weakness,
all right.
In your weakness, he is made strong.
Hallelujah.
When you realize that I can't, but he already has, yeah, then the wall will come tumbling down.
Hallelujah.
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 That's good. Saints of God, when they came to this place on that seventh day, I know without a shadow of doubt they were worn out. Brother John, if they were given a sword or a shield, they wouldn't be able to carry it. Some of you right now need to put that down. You're trying to defeat things in your own strength and your own ability, and we're here again on a Sunday morning. You could have been here for a year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years. The exact same thing has been on your heart that God has been trying to get out of you. We're here again on a Sunday. God is saying, no longer. It's time today to get out of you. Today. Unless you want to stand on the outside of Jericho walls and just dream about what it could be to be totally free in Christ Jesus.
Come on.
Saints of God, it involved death. This is what many don't like. After the walls fell down, the Israelites went into Jericho and killed everything that lives, with the exception of Rahab and her family. Because they had a cord on the wall that represented down the window, represented the blood of Christ, and that they were covered by the blood of the Lamb. Everybody else died. And I know this might sound extreme to you, but God knew that if the people of Jericho were allowed to live, they would influence people of Israel away from him. So when the walls of the stronghold came down, everything in that city must die. And I tell you here today, friends, when you come to the place where you can identify those strongholds in your life, they must die. You must give it to the Lord. You must allow him to bury it in the grave and come back up a new creation in Christ Jesus. It's not time to take it back. It's time to give it up and once and for good. No longer back to the altar, come home. Same thing. Back to the altar, come home. Same thing. Repentance, forgiveness. Repentance, serving God. Sin. No, enough of that, God.
Amen.
Saints of God, whatever it takes, there are some here today that need to bring some strongholds to the altar today, and they must put it to death by the blood of the Lamb. Some things must be allowed to live. Amen. Those things that are in your heart, that are the fruits of the Spirit, once you realize that it's sucking you dry from serving God, those things that are stronghold is weighing you back. It's a yoke around your neck. You see, I want to do. I know what God's called me to do.
Yeah.
You move 5 feet and you're weary and you're tired. You take a break. No, God is saying, I've come to take that yoke from you.
Good.
My yoke is easy, my burden is light.
Yes.
In that way, when we're walking around after church and during the week, I know after Sunday everybody's excited, on Wednesday everybody's excited, but I like to see somebody on a Thursday or Friday or Saturday out in Walmart. Amen? How are you?
Good.
What's wrong? Good. Everything. Sure you want to open up that can? Cast out demons. You rejoice because your name is written in the Lamb's Book of Life. So you're saved today. Amen.
Good.
Whatever it takes, come to the altar and say, God, I am not leaving this place with this stronghold. I'm not. I've decided in my heart, not just for me, but for you, God, for my wife, for my kids, for my family. I'm coming today and I'm walking out of here with no yoke of bondage. I'm going to be free in the house of God today. Glory to God. Saints of God, think about it. The problem with Jericho wasn't the city. It was the people in the city.
That's right. That's right.
I know for many of us today, that's many of our problems as well. You can live on an island by yourself and you would think you'd be good. But I'm going to tell you this, you might better run from man, but you can't run from the three scriptures, me, myself, and I.
That's right.
Hallelujah. You're on an island by yourself, you think you're by yourself, and you got four people there. Me, myself, and I, and the Holy Ghost. And you've been trying to run for years, and you've been trying to get away, but God is calling you today. He's saying, for every one of you, I believe this message is not just for one of you. I believe it's for every one of you. Because I know that every person in the sound of my voice today has something, a stronghold in their life, in their heart. It could be money, it could be finances, it could be bitterness, it could be a critical spirit. Oh, I know there's a lot here today.
I wouldn't have done it that way.
Then when I told you, I wouldn't have done it anyway.
Yeah.
Talk about when we first opened up the church. First opened up the church, Pastor King's all excited. We just have a place to call our home. People walk in here, the first thing they do.
I wouldn't have did that.
Hallelujah.
Thought it would be big up
again. Amen.
Come on.
That's funny, but that's a critical spirit. Amen. And many of us in the house of God have that. What about pride? I believe many of us, before we go forward with God for the walls to tear down in Jericho, we must give the Lord our pride. Men, I'm talking to the men in the house today. Men, some women, but mostly men. When is the last time some of you men cried?
Yeah.
Not because you got far. Not because something happened in your family, you lost a loved one. When is the last time you cried because you were in the presence of God?
Yes.
When is the last time you've been in here, actually showed any emotions to the things of God?
Come on.
Excitement in your heart. Maybe even a move in your spirit that you, oh wretched man that I am, God. When is the last time that has happened in your heart or in your mind? Not because of circumstances you cried, but because the Holy Ghost has been touching your heart.
Yes.
When is the last time you've been in here? I want to look at everyone and go, when is that last time that has happened? Because I know this, every time I really come in contact with my Savior, He shows me who I'm not, but then He shows me who He's going to make me to be, and I rejoice at it. Hallelujah. Yes. What about some of you today that you, with these drugs? And I'm not just talking about those drugs that you buy in Four Corners.
Yeah.
Now I'm going to speak to a group of you today. And I know the Lord's placed this in my heart. I got it written down in my sermon. Amen.
Go ahead.
There's many of you here today. I know the Lord wants to deliver you from those uppers and downers, happy pills and sad ones. You've been dependent on it for way too long. God is telling you in the house today that He's your joy. He's your peace. You need strength to get up in the morning, He'll give it to you. Amen. You need peace to be able to lay down your head at night, He'll give it to you. You need rest, He'll give it to you. Don't justify the doctor prescribed it because now I can keep taking it. Let's be honest, many who do that abuse it. Amen. Abuse it. I don't abuse it. You abuse it if you've been on it longer than a couple years. My God is more than able. My God can do it for me. I'm standing up here today. He'll do it for you.
Amen.
What about those that are bound in here, saints of God, with alcohol? And I'm going to mention, what about lust and fornication?
Come on.
What about wandering eyes and a wandering heart? That's strongholds. You'll never be the man or the woman that God has for you unless you come and give it to God.
That's right.
What about unforgiveness?
Yes.
I believe there's many in this house today that have unforgiveness in their heart. I believe that without a shadow of a doubt. What about envy? What about covetousness? What about hatred? The Bible calls hatred in your heart murder.
Yes.
And I said a couple hate him. I just throw him in this life.
Yeah.
Well, I sure don't hate him, but if they live or die, don't bother me. I've heard some of y'all say that.
Come on.
Things of God, that's hatred. That's murder in your heart. And that's a stronghold in your life. That until you give that to God, you'll never be set free from it. Ever. You'll never be who God has called you to be until you can walk freely in God without those strongholds that the adversary has put around your neck. And you start adding all of those things: alcohol, drugs, doubt, unbelief, religion, fornication, adultery. That's a lot of weight on you. That no wonder why you get weary and tired. But I know this, when you start taking it off,
hallelujah,
it's joy and speaking with full of glory. When you start saying, I can't, but he can, and you can't even undo it from your neck, he grabs it from you. You don't even have the strength to give it to God, let's be honest. You don't have that strength, but God will come in and take it from you. He said, move your hands, put your hands down. I'm going to take it off of you. Saints of God, as the worship team comes up, some of you are trying too hard. And I want to invite you to come to Jesus to lay down the sword and hand him your shoe this evening. This is what your prayer needs to be. Lord, I can't do it, but you can. And I'm telling you here today that it's not because I poured some special oil on the altar. It's not, but it's a step of faith. And every time in the Bible, almost every single time that Christ called someone, he called them to step out, to show a step of faith. It might be just one of you in here today that is bound by something. You're going to stand up and say, that's me, Brother Kid. God's been touching my heart. And I bet in about 50 of them are going to follow you. Because to be honest with you, all of us, every single one of us in this place is dealing with strongholds in our life. But it's about time the house of God and the children of God been set free from the things of God.
Hallelujah.
Saints of God. Some of you here today never had that first confrontation with the man named Jesus. You never really given your life to the Lord. Today is that day.
Yes, sir.